Hello everyone. In this video, I'm going to be talking about how to measure lung function. Now, when we look at lung function or measure lung function, what we're ultimately doing is determining whether a person's lungs are functioning normally or not, whether they're taking in the quantity of sort of air, if you like, that we expect them to. Now, there is a machine called a spirometer that can be used to measure the volume of air breathed in and breathed out, and it produces what's called a spirometer trace. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk about this particular formula that I've written up on the slide here, and I'll explain why I've written that and what it means, and then we'll look at one of these spirometer traces and explain what they can show. So pulmonary ventilation, or PV, as it's sometimes written, is a measure of lung function. And what it does is tell you the volume of air that is taken into the lungs in a single minute. And its units are decimeter cubed per minute. So two things just to note. Pulmonary ventilation has units of decimeter cubed per minute. And tidal volume and ventilation rate are the two things that are used to work it out. So tidal volume is the volume of air in each breath. So the tidal volume written as TV would be a volume. Now that could either be in cubic decimeters, which would be dm cubed, or it's sometimes recorded in liters, because 1 decimeter cubed is actually the same as 1 liter. So the tidal volume is the volume of air in each breath. The ventilation rate is the number of breaths per minute. So VR, that would be the units of minute to the minus one, which means per. So if we times the volume of air in each breath by the number of breaths per minute, that gives us our pulmonary ventilation. The volume of air taken into the lungs every minute. So let's just put an example in place here to show how this kind of works. So tidal volume is usually about 0.4 decimeter cubed. So put there 0.4. Now at rest, the average person, I mean, I'm presuming my ventilation rate is roughly about 15 breaths. I can take about 15 breaths a minute. So ventilation rate of 15, tidal volume of 0.4. That will give me a pulmonary ventilation of 6. And remember, we need the units. 6 decimeter cubed per minute. And that's how you use that formula. But what we're going to look at now is a spirometer trace to show not just how much air we're able to breathe in, how much we can breathe out, but it shows things like our tidal volume. It shows our vital capacity as well, which is the maximum volume of air that can be exchanged in one single breath. So let's talk about the spirometer trace. Okay, so for this, we'll shrink the screen just a little bit, move it further up. I'm going to draw a graph in the straightest of lines, and we'll have a scale. So 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, etc. And this can be our time that we're recording seconds. And what we'll have up the side, we'll have volume of gas in the lungs and we'll record that in decimeter cubed. Now, in fact, we need to put a little scale in, so we'll have 1, 2, 3, 6. I'll explain why the scale's gone up to 6 in just a moment. Of 0 there. So what you get is something that looks a little bit like this. Now, there's a kind of typical spirometer trace. So let's explain where this kind of shape comes from and what this graph really shows, what we can deduce from this trace. So this region here, if I will extend it across, this kind of space or that portion represents there what's called our tidal volume. So we'll write this in, if we use green just to make it a bit different. That is called our tidal volume that we've referred to in the formula. Now the tidal volume is the volume of air you breathe in and out in one normal breath. So you can see the graph just goes up and down and up and down. So we've got the volume of gas in the lungs raising when we've breathed in, falling when we exhale and breathe out. So that's what our tidal volume is, this segment of graph just in the middle where I've highlighted in blue. That's our tidal volume. So let's look at what's going on actually in this graph. So we've had our tidal volume in place. So let's think about what's going on in this part here, because where we have this big peak, that's where we've had basically a deep breath in. And equally down at the bottom here, where the graph appears to fall, that would be a deep breath out. But there are a few other things you can spot on this spirometer trace. So we're going to use a few other different colours to highlight what we're talking about here. You'll notice there's a region from here to the axis. So this space that I've just highlighted in purple here, it's sort of from the lowest point on this graph to the bottom, to the x-axis. That represents what's known as a residual volume. Now, even if you breathe out really hard, there is some air left in the lungs to make sure they stay open. And that's what our residual volume is. That's why this graph never hits zero for the volume of gas in the lungs. It never goes to that x-axis. We're left with what's called our residual volume. So if let's think about this as a whole. So from the very peak of this graph, so from here, let's draw it in black, all the way down to the bottom. I'll just emphasize that bottom point there. This represents what's known as our total lung capacity. Total lung capacity. Now that's really important. The total lung capacity is the total volume of air you can possibly fit into your lungs, and that's about 6 litres. Which, well, I've said litres, but we've got 1 litre is the same as 1 decimetre cubed. So even though I've got decimeter cubed here as a unit, it means the same thing. So 6 decimeters cubed, or 6 litres, that's what our total lung capacity is. That's how much we can possibly fit into the lungs. Now, if we take our total lung capacity and deduct from that our residual volume, what you're left with is the region essentially from our highest peak on this red line, which is here, to our lowest point here, which is where I've drawn this residual volume to. Now that, and I'll colour this in, I won't do yellow just to distinguish it from the rest. That measurement there represents the final thing I'm going to label here, and it's what's called our vital capacity. The vital capacity is the maximum volume of air that can be exchanged in one breath. So when you breathe out, or breathe in heavily rather, and then also come back to rest and breathe out heavily, the maximum volume of air that could be exchanged in a single breath, that's what we refer to as our vital capacity. And we calculate that by doing our total lung capacity minus the residual volume, the bit of air that is still just left in our lungs, essentially, that we're not able to get rid of. And that is ultimately how you analyse a spirometer or a spirometer trace. So we'll just very quickly recap again. So we've drawn the trace in red. This region that I've coloured in, or that I've highlighted by blue dashed lines, I'll just emphasise it once again. In fact, we'll do it all the way across. That represents our tidal volume, which is the volume of air you just breathe in and out in a normal breath, just at rest. We've got a total lung capacity, which is the total volume of air we can fit into the lungs, about 6 litres. We have the residual volume. So even after we've had a deep breath out, there's a certain amount of air remaining in the lungs, and that's what our residual volume is. And so the maximum volume of air that can be exchanged in a single breath is what we know as the vital capacity, which is total lung capacity minus residual volume. Now, that graph does look very thorough. There's a lot to it. But if you watch this video back slower, we introduce each one in turn. And that's just a way of how we measure lung function. So we measure the pulmonary ventilation, so we need to know tidal volume and ventilation rate, and then we can get somebody to get a spirometer trace for us, and we can analyse data in the way that we've done just in this video. Now, I'd like to finish this one just by giving or talking about two particular examples of exam questions that you might see. Just quickly sketch them, just so you can put this into a real-life context. So we'll shrink this down again. And we'll just leave that there. I just want to very quickly sketch two graphs, and then I'll suggest the question that could be asked. So here's the first. This is point A, that's point B. We'll put some numbers in. We'll say that here's 2, 3, same scale as my previous graph. Now, the question could be, what happened between points A and B? Now, clearly, because we have a rise and then a fall, that would imply that somebody has taken a very deep breath in here, but then they've also taken a very sharp breath out. So they've taken a very deep breath in and then a breath breathed out, but exhaled beyond normal. And that's what that has happened between A and B. You could get asked in this example, what is the person's residual volume? And for that, all you'd have to do is look at, on the graph, the distance between here and here. So this area that I've shaded in green, that would represent a residual volume, the amount of air left in the lungs. So there's one kind of scenario. Let's just do one more. Because many students ask me about lung function, they say that this is the graph or this trace is quite tricky to understand. So I want to put it into context by doing these two exam questions. So let's imagine we have something that's a bit more like this. Not drawn amazingly well, but the same setup with volume of gas in the lungs on the y-axis, time on the x-axis in seconds. And you might get a question like, describe and explain two features of the graph which show that somebody is exercising. Now, I'm sure we can appreciate that the size there is quite notably different to the size of the graph here. We have a greater peak and an even lower trough on this graph. So there's one of the signs that they're exercising, because if we think back to what we said about tidal volume, or the volume of air you breathe in and out in a normal breath, you can see quite clearly that that is increasing as time goes on. So that's indicating they're exercising, because the tidal volume, the amount of air they're taking in to the lungs and exhaling, is increasing. But also, and I'm hoping I've drawn it clear enough on this graph, that you can see that the distance horizontally is also decreasing. In fact, that we have what appears to be the waves a bit more compressed here than they do here. So the wavelength, if you like, of the waves is getting shorter. Now that would imply that we're exercising, because we're breathing faster. So that we're inhaling and exhaling at a faster rate. So the wavelength of the waves where I've drawn section one is much smaller than in sort of section two. The waves are getting closer and closer to one another. And a question you might get is, calculate the percentage increase in tidal volume from when the person is at rest to when they're breathing most deeply. So if tidal volume is volume of air you breathe in and out, all you would need to do is measure this volume here that I've recorded in blue, and we'll call that A. Measure that volume that we'll record there as B. And if we want the percentage increase in tidal volume, then what we'll need to do is work out the difference between A and B as a percentage of B. And that's how you would answer that question. So you look at A, look at B, work out the difference between the two, divide that by B, so the original, and times that by 100 to get the percentage difference in that tidal volume. So there's just two examples of exam-style questions you could get related to lung function. Okay, I hope all that helps.